this is actually my first user meeting, although I've been working with in and out for 6 years or more at this point. So what I'm going to do today is I'm not going to talk about the partner proposal that Scott alluded to with respect to software development. I'm going to try to touch upon some of the themes that came up at the beginning of the meeting with respect to systems biology. How we can approach systems biology in the context of microbial communities. Maybe we'll call it systems ecology. And then I want to talk about how we can apply proteomics to trying to validate some of the metabolic pathway reconstruction that comes out of large-scale sequencing projects like the capacity that the JGI offers for community sequencing. And so from Fjords to open seas, we're going to be focusing specifically, though, on a particular ecological phenomenon in the ocean that has to do with oxygen deficiency and the expansion of the ocean that are oxygen deficient. Before I go into too deep, I want to acknowledge the people that make this work happen. Our partners, specifically the Institute for Ocean Sciences in Canada, the Joint Genome Institute, the Community Sequencing Program for providing sequencing capacity, and the Pacific Northwest National Lab here for actually really being patient with us over the years of developing these environmental proteomic approaches that I'll talk about today. And then, of course, in my laboratory, I've folded some of the people that are actively involved in generating and analyzing the data. And we have partners at the Stanford Research International, which I won't talk about today, but developing computational approaches to pathway reconstruction. So what I want to do is talk about this microbial systems ecology paradigm, how we might consider practicing it. I think it's important to have a conceptual overview before we jump into the actual experimental framework. Then I want to talk specifically about expanding oxygen minimum zones as a use case for interpreting and actuating this paradigm. We're specifically going to explore the Line P transect, which is an ocean-going journey that happens in the northeastern subarctic Pacific Ocean 3 times a year that's been going on for about 50 years. And then I'm going to explore structure-function relationships with respect to community metabolism using proteomic approaches. So you all recognize this. This is the matrix. It's the computer code that defines human reality in a world where humans are batteries for an artificial intelligence civilization. I think I got that right. And that matrix is in part guarded by agents, and I don't have the sentinels here, but those agents are there to protect the integrity of the matrix. They're there to effectively remove human consciousness that is sort of holding up to the physical and chemical realities of the world. What I want to emphasize today, I bring that up, though, because there are some striking parallels with our emerging awareness of the biological matrix. Okay, this is the bits and bytes of the genes and seeds of biological code that defines the metabolic potential of all living things, that binds together all living things with respect to the matter and energy transformations that organisms, populations, communities, and ecosystems can manifest in the world. And the agents, I want to argue, of this biological matrix have been and continue to be found primarily in the microbial world. So microbes are the guardians of metabolism, and they provide and form essential ecosystem services, which have important effects, essential effects, life-changing effects on biochemical cycles of the Earth system. And what we have to consider in the context of these microbial agents is how we look at how we view, how we define metabolism, and what our conventional views allow us to do, and maybe how we can explore some less conventional views of metabolism in the context of microbial communities. The first thing is this is a map of metabolism, right? And we think about metabolism as the synthesis or the decomposition of chemicals in a cell that could be organized into pathways represented by graphs, right? And so here's a keg pathway. We have a vertex, which is a chemical, a substrate, or a product. And we have an edge, which is an enzyme, so nodes and edges. And most of what we know about metabolism, of course, comes from studies of single cells, okay? So this is rightly so, because we can perturb those cells and we can do And so here we have a pathway derived from a single cell, and our genetic and biochemical understanding of that pathway is derived from studies at the single cell level. But the situation changes when we move into the microbial world, when we try to understand the relationships among different cellular components of an ecosystem. Okay? And so we have to look at the community to some extent as a whole. And so in this case, metabolism can be thought of as a distributed process, where this particular cell may contribute one part of a reaction, the product of that reaction may be used as a starting point, and so forth and so on through the entire community. And so we want to understand how these forms of distributed metabolic pathways arise and how they're regulated in naturally occurring communities. And so this brings us to the concept of community metabolism, and the goal here is to find and compare these distributed pathways among and between microbes in the environment to better understand biogeochemical cycle. And the conventional way that we're doing that right now is primarily through sequencing. Okay, so if we have our microbial community as a plurality here, we can conduct metagenomic sequencing, whether that's at the DNA and more these days at the RNA level, to look at gene expression profiling. But then we have the problem of actually putting that back together again. And so we have fragments of genomic information that we have to somehow bid to pathways and to taxonomic groups. We now have emerging single-cell sequencing technologies that let us individuate from the plurality a particular genotype that we can sequence not to completion typically, but to some fraction of that genome equivalent, and therefore allows us to perform metabolic pathway reconstruction on, you know, that coherent cell or genotype, as well as the combination of the two approaches where we can use these single cell genomes as fragment recruitment platforms for this plurality sequencing approach, both at the DNA and RNA level. The idea is that this unification of single cell and plurality sequencing approaches will enable us to really identify these distributed patterns within microbial community and to understand how they change over time. And so the paradigm here is that we go from this biological matrix that we have difficulty comprehending to an appreciation for how the information in the matrix is distributed among different cellular components of the ecosystem, and then how that distribution and the interaction of those components give rise to global and large-scale biogeochemistry. And so this is a quote from Penny Chisholm. This is over 10 years old now. It's a white paper to NSF, but I think it was very prescient. The regulation of the pools and the fluxes in biogeochemical cycles have their origins in the genetic inventory of individual microbes, and the regulation of these genes within the organism is determined by the environment. As such, one can look at the microbial food web as a collection of genomes whose expression and replication is coordinated with complex feedback loops at the organismal population ecosystem level. So this was, in a way, thinking about metabolism as food web within the microbial. So the foundational questions that we want to answer with respect to this paradigm are, I'm going to summarize this fourfold here, but there are probably others. What is the taxonomic and functional structure of that ecosystem? How does this structure change in response to environmental perturbation? What are the ecological consequences of this change? And are these observations extensible to other ecosystems? So this is, if we can answer such questions, this is the formulation, this is the basis for conducting systems ecology. So I want to focus in now on a particular use case here where we can try to resolve answers to this question. And that specific use case is this ecological phenomenon of oxygen minimum zone expansion. I might refer to them as ONZs or OMZs now that I'm in Canada. So if we look at a map of global oxygen distribution, okay, so this is taking the lowest oxygen concentration in a particular depth wherever there's been a measurement in the global ocean. So the blue colors indicate low oxygen at some depth, the minimum level, and the red would indicate high levels of oxygen. What you can see is that there are extensive regions of oxygen deficiency in the Pacific Ocean here, off the coast of North and South America. We see regions of low oxygen off the coast of Africa here. We have the Arabian Sea, the Indian Ocean, as well, the Black Sea and the Baltic Sea. And over here, you can't quite see it, we have the Cariaco Basin, which is also an anoxic system in the ocean. And currently, about 7% of the global ocean is classified as being oxygen deficient using a cutoff of about 20 micromolar oxygen. And the concern is that as temperatures rise, as sea water temperatures rise, you see an increased thermal stratification of the water column, which reduces circulation patterns and actually leads to enhanced oxygen deficiency. And so this is a particular trend line that's taken from the central equatorial Pacific Ocean. Again, the red colors here indicate high levels, the blue colors indicate low levels of oxygen. Here, depth is shown as pressure. And this is a projection as well as a measurement series from 1960 to about 2006 that's showing that there's an expansion of the hypoxic boundary layer, the central equatorial Pacific Ocean, and a net oxygen loss of about 74 millimeters squared per year. So it seems as though as the oceans warm up, the oxygen levels decline. Okay. And so we want to think about this from an ecological standpoint, what the implications might be for the microbial community structure and function, and the feedback on biogeochemical cycles in the environment. And so one way to think about that is with respect to energy flow through the system as a function of oxygen concentration. And so this is a sort of a mock-up here that shows on the y-axis the energy that's available to mobile predators, so things that graze, from about 0% to 100%. And on the x-axis, we have oxygen concentration, this time in micromole per kilogram, which is a standard oceanographic way of presenting the data. And so we're going from oxic through dysoxic, suboxic to anoxic water column conditions. And as we move along in this direction, we see that less and less of the energy becomes available to multicellular organisms, primarily. Okay. And as we move into the anoxic world, microbes dominate the energy transformations. And as we do that, as we move from high to low, we also move through the electron tower, and we start to see the use of alternative terminal electron acceptors, oxygen being the most favorable, but then we see nitrate, manganese, iron, sulfate, and finally carbon dioxide used as these terminal electron acceptors. And as this transition occurs, there are implications because the end products of those transformations, for instance, the respiration of nitrate, actually produces the greenhouse gas nitrous oxide and leads to biological nitrogen loss through the formation of N2 gas. The use of carbon dioxide as a terminal electron acceptor can produce the greenhouse gas methane, and so forth. So we are interested and concerned about oxygen mineral zone expansion with respect to both the production of greenhouse gases as well as the loss of fixed nitrogen in the system, which depletes the ocean of nutrients. The other thing that's pretty interesting about that energy flow curve is it also implies that microorganisms may exist at different niches based on the redox state of the water column. You can imagine a particular group that's very well adapted to different locations, different oxygen tensions that can tune its physiology, basically change its gene expression. You may also imagine groups that are completely replaced as a function of oxygen concentration because they have certain dependencies. So it creates a very interesting dynamic with respect to the adaptation of microbes, both at the genomic and the physiological level, and the interactions between microorganisms as a function of redox state. Now, what's particularly interesting is that you can also have similar types of processes occurring at different ecological scales. So, for instance, on sinking particles in the ocean, so that organic matter is produced and sinks down to the bottom, you can actually have oxygen gradients that support anaerobic processes in an otherwise aerobic water column. You can also have an anaerobic water column, of course, where some of these terminal electron acceptors are being used as well sequentially, but also simultaneously, depending on the presence of particles. So this creates some interesting interaction space for those distributed pathways that I mentioned at the outset. Okay, so let's move beyond the conceptual framework here and look directly at a particular region of the ocean where we can try and study these relationships in more detail. And so the Line P transect is an ocean-going transect, as I mentioned. It's been in existence for over 50 years. It leaves Saanich Inlet here on the coast of Vancouver Island and steams out 1,400 kilometers to Ocean Station Papa. So it's quite a long transect. And as I said, it's been going on for quite some time. There are several major stations that are called P4, P12, P16, P20. Ocean Station Papa, which is the terminal branch, of course, is also called P27. So this transect runs three times per year. Okay, so it runs in the spring, and the summer, and the winter. And it basically collects data. That's what it's been doing for many decades. And around 2006, we began participating in the cruises and sampling the water column for the microbial community structure and function associated with not the surface ocean, which had been the dominant focus of the transect, but the interior ocean. So if you remember that diagram that I showed you at the outset of the oxygen minimum zones, this transect actually follows the world's largest oxygen minimum zone, the ocean. So this is what it looks like in cross-section along the winding transect. So what you're looking at here is the terminal station, at P26 or Ocean Station Papa. You're looking at oxygen concentrations in the water column there from 1962 to 2009. And so what we can see, just like I showed you for the equatorial Pacific, is that if you follow the trend, that in the core here between 500 and 1500 meters, we see increasing oxygen deficiency as a function of time. Okay, so this trend is global, and it's particularly acute along the transect. And so, as I mentioned, for many decades, people were very focused on primary production up here and photosynthetic activity. They really didn't think much about what was happening down here. And so we've been trying to understand, from coastal to open ocean, how these changes in the oxygenation status of the water column have impacted the microbial community. And so our work plan here, from the standpoint of designing experiments or at least surveying the environment, is multiple components. It's maybe beyond three now, but I've simplified it. This is pretty standard, but it's I think important to know how we process information, how we collect information. We're collecting information in Saanich Inlet, which I'll talk about shortly, and in these major stations, P4, P12, P16, P20, and P26. Collect large volumes of water for some of the DNA and RNA-based, protein-based approaches. We also have these higher resolution samples where we just use the material for cell counts and for taxonomic inventories. And so we concentrate microbial biomass from the waters. We do various extractions for nucleic acids and proteins. We also have started a single-cell genome initiative, which is actually very, very simple, because in that case, you're taking a very small amount of water, putting it in glycerol, and you're storing it prior to FACT sorting. So this is, in some ways, a transformational approach to study the community, because now in a milliliter of seawater, we can access the genotypic diversity that normally 20 liters of seawater or 200 liters of seawater in the past was required for plurality. Okay, so after we go through this process of various extractions and data generation, we have had to develop several pipelines to analyze the information, and ultimately we want to look at that bits and bytes of sequence information in the context of environmental parameter data, looking at multivariate statistics and also doing various clustering approaches to generate networks. So one of the things that I wanted to emphasize about the system that we're studying along the Lyme transect is that if we look at the ribosomal RNA gene as this general marker for taxonomic structure of the water column, and we compare that to other regions of the global ocean, what we can see is that the surface waters, okay, along the Lyme transect from this Saanich Inlet location, which is the beginning, into the northeastern suburb Pacific, which represents the coastal to open transition along the transect, and then the Hawaii ocean time series data. Okay, you see the surface waters here, relatively clustered together with respect to microbial community structure. And then if you go into the oxygen deficient regions, what you find is that Saanich Inlet and the core of the oxygen minimum zone along the Lyme P transect, specifically the coastal system, cluster together. And then the open ocean system, oxygen regions cluster together. So that there are multiple community structures that are associated with these changing levels of oxygen. And if you then ask which microbial groups are representative of each of those structures, you can use this type of format to visualize the frequency distribution of those groups. I know that it's complicated. The point is that there's a lot of diversity, but you can start to see that there are groups that are more associated with oxic surface waters, and then other groups that are more associated with anoxic waters. And then there are groups that are associated with intermediate oxygenation states as well. And so if we focus on the four major groups that are most prevalent within the oxygen minimum zone, what we can find is that effectively there are the alpha proteobacteria represented by this SAR11 group, the gamma proteobacteria represented by this SUP5 and ARNIC96BE19 group, the delta proteobacteria represented by this SAR324 group, and this uncultured group known as the marine group A, which is probably a phylum level designation for a group of marine bacteria that have yet to be characterized. So these four taxa represent groups that are very prevalent in the oxygen deficient water. But it turns out that they're also prevalent in the dark ocean in general. And so one of the big questions that we have to try to resolve is that what level of differentiation are we looking at with respect to the adaptations of these taxa and their physiological and therefore biogeochemical influences. That is to say, are we looking at different genomic variants that are tuned to specific environments, or are we looking at these panmictic groups that are able to tune their physiology depending on the environmental conditions that they encounter? So one way to look at that is to cluster the taxonomic information into various operational taxonomic units. And here, we're just clustering sequence information for the ribosomal RNA gene at 97% identity. And I'm showing you a map here of different environments and different sequence clusters, and then this is the distribution of those different sequence clusters with oxygen concentration mapped over here. And the take-home message is there's a great deal of diversity within each one of these groups, and that to a certain extent, that diversity can be mapped to particular environments, so there could be a biogeography component, and it can be mapped to different oxygen concentrations. But this is not uniform, because some groups are also widely distributed. They have lower diversity, but they're found under multiple different environmental conditions, which suggests some form of physiological tuning. So I can show you for each one of those major groups, they're different amounts of diversity, different major abundant OTUs. The take-home message, though, is that we can then use that information and develop correlation and co-occurrence networks to try to reconstruct what we think might be ecological relationships, dependency relationships. This could be trophic exchanges in a distributed metabolic network. This could be predator-prey relationships. This could just be the fact that they have similar metabolic needs and occupy the same niche. And so if we do that, we take that information that was in the original bubble diagram that I showed, and we do a co-occurrence network, and then we highlight specific nodes of interest, those four taxonomic groups that I just highlighted, and a few others that show up, what we find is that multiple OTUs for the same taxonomic group will show up in this network connected in different ways. And so that suggests that there are different ensembles, there are different interaction spaces that microorganisms will find themselves in depending on the environmental conditions. And so if you take this network, what the nodes are done here is scale to oxygen concentration. So this would be surface nodes moving into the anoxic water column. We've color-coded those four taxa of emerging interest and a few others that are prevalent. And what you can see is as we move from oxic into dysoxic, suboxic, and anoxic, that there are multiple OTUs in this case. You can see SAR11 show up in multiple places. You can see the SAR224 group show up in multiple places. And you can see, for instance, the SUP5 group show up in multiple places as well. And so this is very interesting with respect to how these different microorganisms organize their metabolic relationships with other microbes under different redox states. We can also look at the connectivity pattern and using between centrality as a metric to say, how many friends do you have? How well connected in the environment? And it turns out that many of the same groups that I highlighted here, right, in terms of the taxonomic distribution as a function of oxygen, are also very well connected. So they form hubs in the overall network. Now, we don't understand what that particularly means with respect to the ecology, but we can suggest that if you remove that group, that that would have implications with respect to matter and energy transformations in the environment. The other thing I want to point out is that with respect to the size here now is not scaled with oxygen anymore, it's scaled with the abundance of that particular operational taxonomic unit. And what you can see is that not always the most abundant operational taxonomic unit is the most connected. And so from an ecological point of view, these lower abundance but well-connected members of the community could represent keystone species that play essential roles in keeping things together. So the network analysis reveals non-random patterns of co-occurrence between taxa that are associated with different oxygenation states in the water column and these different oxygen-deficient environments. And there were these four groups, these taxa of emerging interest, that dominated dysoxic, suboxic, and non-subnetworks. This is consistent with overlapping habitat preference and potential for metabolite exchange. Moreover, there were multiple low abundance OQs that form hubs in the larger network that are based on the number of connections running through them, consistent with what the previous reported as keystone connectivity in marine ecosystems. So what we want to be able to do, though, is to move beyond specifically the taxonomic association of who's there, and now, to some extent, how are they connected to form these metabolic interaction spaces, but to go from the network of taxonomic interactions to the functional properties of those cells in the ecosystem. And one way we can do that is basically on the premise of sequence data alone, primary sequence data. We can look at the metagenomes. This now is data taken directly from this static inlet basin, which I will highlight again in the context of proteomics. And we can use some statistical approaches to look for genes that are specifically associated with different water column compartments. So in red, you're seeing genes that are, in this case, actually ensembles of genes or pathways that are primarily associated in red with the oxic component of the water column, in green, the intermediate dysoxic, suboxic compartments, and then in blue, the anoxic compartment of the water column. And so we can see that there are specific pathways that are found primarily within a given compartment. So in the case of the anoxic region of the water column, we see the denitrification, nitrate reduction, methanogenesis. These are those pathways that come online as the oxygen is depleted and alternative terminal electron acceptors are utilized, are statistically significant and enriched in the anoxic compartment. We actually see some interesting pathways for plant hormone biosynthesis and so forth in the oxy compartment of the water column that we're trying to understand in the context of signaling between bacteria and algae. But how does it actually work? Because this is a hypothesis, right? This is a series of pathways that seem to be correlated with the group of taxonomic, operational taxonomic units that form, we think, these co-occurrence relationships. But how does it work? How are the genes expressed? And to what extent are those pathways really active? And so we use static inlet along that transect as our actual model ecosystem because it's a seasonally anoxic basin. So effectively, over the time course of the year, it goes from being stratified, where you can see oxygen depleted in the water column, and then nitrate depleted in the water column a little bit below where oxygen goes to zero, and then the accumulation of hydrogen sulfide. So in the summertime, you'll see hydrogen sulfide accumulate at about 200, between 200 and 150 meters. And during the fall, what happens is that there's a deep water renewal, and oxygenated nutrient-rich water flows over the sill here into the deeper water. You can see oxygen appear down here, and you can also see nitrate appear down here. So the system resets itself every year. So we use this as a natural laboratory to look at the microbial community responses to these changing levels of what are called oxygen deficiency and try to extrapolate that into the open ocean where, you know, larger scale processes are happening. We want to be able to model that ultimately because that has a bigger effect on, let's say, trace gas flux into the atmosphere. So this is the mean annual oxygen in static inlet over almost a 50-year time period. It's just been stacked on top. And so from winter into winter months, what you can see is that as the progression from winter into spring into the peak of summer is concerned, you see this oxygen efficiency in the deep water, and then as you move into the fall, you see this influx of oxygenated water into the basin. And so what we wanted to do is to actually set up an experiment. And in this case, we went in spring during early stratification, and we picked three compartments in the water column: the disoxic compartment, the suboxic compartment, and the anoxic sulfidic compartment. So here's the metadata associated with those conditions, just to give you an idea of why we picked these particular depth intervals. And we first looked at the taxonomic composition of those depth intervals, and then we conducted a proteomic investigation to see if we could identify the expression of specific pathways that were indicated in our earlier statistical analysis of the metagenome. And so effectively, we wanted to ask the question, are these pathways that are indicated as being diagnostic for a particular compartment of the water column also actively expressed? And so this is just to give you an overview of the types of numbers that we're working with. We tried working with different amounts of sample. So we actually tried filtering about a liter of water to recover proteins, and 10 liters was our second effort, just to see how they scale. We didn't actually see a huge difference in the recovery of proteins, which was a bit odd for some of these conditions. But overall, we were dealing with thousands, over 10,000 peptides, and several thousand human proteins. So if we map those onto a taxonomic hierarchy represented in the metagenome, so what you can see here, this is the NCBI taxonomy. It's the kind of thing you'd see if you were to open up Megan, which is a useful program for looking at metagenome. And in gray boxes, behind the color boxes, you're seeing the percentage of coverage of the metagenome information that we have mapped onto this taxonomic hierarchy. So this is basically the proportion of the metagenome and how it bins to particular taxonomic groups. And then the colored circles represent the proteome. So what proportion of peptides map to proteins that are associated with particular taxonomic groups? And again, the colors code for different depths. So we have 100, 120, 200 meter intervals. And what you can see here is that there is a very interesting shift from the disoxic into the suboxic into the anoxic water column with respect to the proteome and the taxonomic distribution of peptides that we were able to identify. And so as we move from that 100 meter sample, where the crenarchaea are the dominant expressing forms, into the anoxic sulfidic compartment of the water column, where this gamma proteobacterium sub 5 is the dominant expressing form. And so we can see real changes in gene expression as a function of redox state. And if we focus in now from the taxonomic structure to the particular transformations that, you know, we're interested in with respect to carbon, nitrogen, and sulfur metabolism, we can start to discern interesting pathway differentiation as well. So what you're looking at here are nitrogen transformations, sulfur transformations, and carbon transformations, specifically those related to inorganic carbon fixation. So CO2 fixation, okay? And so what we want to get at here is how these different cycles in the marine systems are integrated through individual organisms and ensembles of organisms. And so in terms of the nitrogen cycle, we can, as we move down into, from the oxic, or the disoxic into the anoxic waters, we can see a shift with respect to the taxonomic groups that are most involved in the nitrogen cycle. So we have a complete replacement by the time we get into the sulfidic zone of this denitrifying group. In the intermediate water column, we see the anammox bacteria dominate the system, and we see nitrifiers dominating the system at 100 meters. And so as a function of oxygen tension, we see a shift in from nitrifying activities to nitrogen loss processes, first through the anaerobic ammonium oxidation pathway, and then through a partial denitrification pathway that's expressed in that sub-5 group. With respect to the sulfur cycle, again, this scales with the accumulation of sulfide, which makes sense. With respect to inorganic carbon fixation, we actually see the presence of proteins that are involved in both the acetyl-CoA pathway and the 3-hydroxypropionate cycle, which become more apparent as we move into the anoxic sulfidic waters. So if I had process measurements for both carbon fixation and mean nitrification, I would now be in the position of possibly being able to couple these together. We can also look at coordinated gene expression with respect to target groups. So this is a genomic interval from the sub-O5 group, which contains the denitrification pathway. So it contains two isoforms of nitrate reductase, as well as components of the carbon fixation, the Rubisco gene, and also some of the sulfur oxidation genes that it uses with respect to using sulfur as an electron donor. And as we move down the water column, what we can actually see is that under dysoxy conditions, we're getting expression of this NAT form of nitrate reductase, this periplasmic form, that peaks in the suboxic region of the water column, and then declines again as we hit the anoxic sulfidic region. In the anoxic sulfidic water column, we actually see the presence of the second isoform of nitrate reductase, this NAR form. So this begins to suggest that there's some regulation with respect to subunit selection in the context of these redox transitions that are occurring. So we'd actually really like to explore that more quantitatively. This is not quantitative proteomics at this point. So putting that all together, we're left with a model of sorts. As I'd like to push this theme of metabolic coupling, that as we move from this dysoxic, suboxic, anoxic, and anoxic sulfidic water column conditions, I'm going to focus on just these three groups that were the primary expressors in our system. Now, you might be asking yourselves, there's a lot of diversity. You showed me a map of a lot of bubbles, and you just focused on these three taxonomic groups. Well, those were the three taxonomic groups that had 80% of the proteome. So it's pretty compelling that these were the most active members of the community. So these processes are important with respect to community functions. So we have our nitrifier here, we have our anammox bacteria here, and we have our sub-5 denitrifier here, okay? And then as we move through these different water column conditions, these arrows are changing with respect to flux. This is just a model based on the proteome, okay? So the idea, again, is that the nitrifiers dominate under these conditions. As we move into this transition between suboxic and anoxic, we see the dominance of anammox process, of nitrogen loss. And then under these anoxic sulfidic conditions, this process is shut down, and we see the dominance of this partial denitrification pathway. And what I didn't highlight before is that in the sub-O5 group, we don't see the terminal step for the production of nitrogen from nitrous oxide. The NODZ gene is missing. And so we draw this arrow here as being nitrous oxide producing in the context of this transition. So this is an interesting kind of feedback because I alluded to carbon fixation with respect to CO2, but now I'm telling you that it appears that this group is now producing nitrous oxide on balance. Okay. So where we want to take this now is to combine that approach of plurality sequencing and shotgun proteomics with single-cell genomic sequencing technology. And what we've done is we've gone back to those same compartments of the water column where we have the plurality sequencing data and shotgun proteomics. We've actually done cell sorts with the Bigelow lab. And we've sorted over 4,000 individual cells. We generated close to 2,000 single-cell genomes. This is showing you the distribution of those sorted cells. In gray, you can see the groups that have single-cell genomes that were successfully amplified. And so now we're in the position of trying to have those sequenced so that we can directly map the plurality sequencing data onto these genomic scaffolds to better understand the population structure of these groups. So you go back to those histograms, the heat maps, that show the OTU distributions. We don't get that resolution in the metagenome space because we can't assemble. Here we can actually identify genotypes that are associated with each operational taxonomic unit, and we can ask, is this the one that's expressing? Is that the one that's expressing? And under what conditions? So it really is a game changer with respect to our ability to resolve these microbial community structures and the potential for shared metabolism. We've also gone back and started to measure the rates. And so this is a time window between July, August, and February, so 2010 and 2011, where we used the paired isotope method to measure both the anaerobic ammonium oxidation and denitrification pathways. And what we can see, again, is an interesting process. In the one sample that we had the proteomic data in April, I showed you that there was a clear shift with respect to nitrification and then nitrogen loss processes from anammox to denitrification. Here, we're seeing a temporal transition with respect to those processes. So it's not only spatially regulated, but it's also temporally regulated. So in July, we see a strong anammox signature. So these are potential rates for anammox in the suboxic water column. In August, this is late August, when the renewals first start to happen, we actually see a shift to denitrification as the dominant rate loss, nitrogen loss process. And then during restratification in February, things start to go back to the state they were during peak stratification. So this is just a reminder that it's not just the spatial dimension that we need to be considering, but also the temporal cadence at which these processes unfold. So, although many of the taxa identified in oxygen deficient waters are ubiquitous ocean denizens, patterns of endemism emerge at the level of operational taxonomic units obtained by clustering these small subunit ribosome RNA gene sequences together at specific identity thresholds. We really need to be cognizant of that. The OTU distribution patterns reinforce a model of ecological type selection in which genetically cohesive populations manifest distinct ecological or biogenomical roles. These distinct roles, in turn, form the basis of distributed networks of metabolite exchange integrating phenotypic expression of different taxonomic groups that drive nutrient and climate-active trace gas cycling within the water column. And so the challenge for us going forward, to go back to this original trinity of sorts with respect to the balance between plurality sequencing and single-cell genomics, is that we need to be able to couple that now with these rate process measurements, these gene expression profiles, and the metabolic activity with respect to metabolites themselves, if we're going to properly model these pathways. For instance, I can put forward an idea about metabolite exchange, but in order to really prove that, I'm going to need to be able to measure the metabolites themselves. Moreover, the coupling of rate process and gene expression is going to be another frontier opportunity. And the acquisition of the nanosims, for instance, at EMSL, is a really great opportunity to begin to look at the single cell level in terms of the uptake of particular substrate-product relationships. So I'm going to end there and answer any questions.
We have time for questions.
So Steve, very nice talk. I have a question if I understood correctly. So for your metaproteomic testing, you're basically method for cytogenomic data.
Yeah.
And what kind of sequence do you
use? Yeah, all of that was Sanger sequencing.
So you have all the time.
Yeah, there were actually phosmid end sequences. So low depth of coverage, but high quality.